Psalm 84 is a psalm of great hope. It tells us about the power given to one who has a pilgrim's heart and what God will do to help us in the situations and problems of our life. Listen to this great, wonderful psalm that expresses the yearning of a man after God, the experience of God, and then the capacity to face the difficulties of life through him and with his power. Hear the word of God. How lovely is your tabernacle, O Lord of hosts! My soul longs, yes, even faints, for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh cry out for the living God. Even the sparrow has found a home, and the swallow a nest for herself, where she may lay her young. Even your altars, O Lord of hosts, my King and my God, blessed are those who dwell in your house. They will still be praising you. Blessed is the man whose strength is in you, whose heart is set on pilgrimage. As they pass through the valley of Baca, they make it a spring. The rain also covers it with pools, and they go from strength to strength. Every one of them appears before God in Zion. O God of hosts, hear my prayer. Give ear, O God of Jacob. O God, behold our shield, and look upon the face of your anointed. For a day in your courts is better than a thousand. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of the Lord than dwell in the tents of the wicked. For the Lord God is a sun and a shield. The Lord will give grace and glory. No good thing will he withhold from those who walk uprightly. O Lord of hosts, blessed be the man who trusts in you. Let us pray. Almighty God, we pray for a purpose big enough to give us power in the midst of the perplexities of life. We pray that during this time together that we'll be able to think deeply about where we're going with our lives, what you want us to do, and how you can give us a positive attitude toward the difficulties that we face. Lord, use this time now to speak to each of us as if there were only one of us, and that you had a special personal message for each of us. All praise be to you, Lord. We're listening, Lord. We need you so much. We can't make it without you. And we yield ourselves to you. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Some time ago, I went to a conference and gave a speech on the meaning of the power of God in the perplexities of life. At the end of the conference, I asked each person to do a very special thing to express his or her commitment to dare to live his or her life according to the perspective of God's power rather than his or her limitations. And in order to do that, I asked each person to put his or her hands in front and then put in the hands the picture of his or her life really filled with the power of God, able to do what he had envisioned him or her to dare to believe. Well, the flood of mail afterwards indicated to me that many of us plan our lives around our own adequacy and not the abundancy of God, because many of these people took specific problems and envisioned what God could do in them, caught that picture in the imagination of their minds, and then lifted it up to God and dared to live in that way. A woman who had never expected healing to come in her problem physically pictured herself as whole, and she got well. a man who is having terrible difficulties in his marriage, put that marriage in his hands and pictured what God could do in that relationship, raised it up to God, and through that commitment, started to take the steps toward realizing the dream that God had given him in the picture of his imagination. A man was upset with his job. He didn't see where it was going or how it fit into his real purpose in life. And so he pictured the kind of job he'd like to have to express his real gifts and raised it up to God. A few weeks later, an opening came and he accepted that opportunity and he went on to live in that job as God's person, knowing that the job had been provided. And so on, letter after letter, expressed what one woman said very specifically. You know, I've been living on in my own resources, and I've been calculating what's possible on the basis of what I could do without God anyhow. How amazing. I love to ask the question, what are you trying to attempt right now that you could not pull off without the power of God? And most people, when I ask that question, say, not a thing. Amazing. We live our lives within the confines of our own talents, our own training, our own adequacy, and we wonder then, why is it that so little that's adventuresome or exciting ever happens to us? It's because we never picture anything beyond what we could do by ourselves anyhow. Who needs God then? But when the picture is big enough to need him to accomplish it, then the exciting thing that happens is that he gives the power to do what is a part of his plan for us. That's the way he wants us to live. That's what I call adventuresome living. And in a wonderful way, it's described in this 84th Psalm. The psalmist is describing a pilgrim on his way to Jerusalem for one of the feasts. Now, there are differing views as to whether this is a psalm written by one who was actually in the pilgrimage or one who had been in it and remembered it, and because he had been in it, his whole life had become a pilgrimage and he reaffirmed it. You know, a pilgrim is a wayfarer, somebody who goes from one place to another. It has a deeper meaning, though. It's a word that describes someone who goes to a shrine to worship a god or a power greater than himself. But even deeper than that, a pilgrimage is the description of the progress of our life toward the goals that we set. Now, in this case, the pilgrim described was someone on his way to Jerusalem to celebrate at the feast, probably early in the fall. And his heart was filled with joy and gusto and excitement because he was going to be in the temple of God and worship his Lord. But you catch a deeper undertone as that psalm begins and the psalmist describes his longing to be in the temple. You feel in it the longing we all have to be in the heart of God, not in a temple made with hands, not in a geographical place, not in the architecture of a temple, but to come to the very heart of God. And so you are given the description of the heart of a pilgrim. Let's begin there. What is it? His flesh and his heart long for God. And then he says, blessed is the man whose strength is in you, whose heart is on a pilgrimage. Is your heart on a pilgrimage? Is it on the move towards something, someone, something greater than you could ever do by yourself? Let me ask you this personal question. Let me be audacious enough to really ask you to answer. What is the basic purpose of your life? Seems simple, doesn't it? You know, it's almost become proverbial now in American language that the little example that someone used about a swamp and alligators, when you're up to your waist in alligators, it's pretty hard to remember that your purpose was to drain the swamp. And it's true, we get so full of the alligator problems around us that we forget where we're going and what our real purpose is. Do you find that's true? What's the one thing that guides your whole life? What's the direction? What's your pilgrim's heart? Now, the pilgrim of this psalm wanted God. That was his purpose.
Everything that he did was to get to God's heart. His flesh and his heart longed for that. Could you say that?
The old Scots used to say that man's chief end is to glorify God and to enjoy him forever.
Is that your purpose? How would you state it? How would you put it in your own language?
Where is your pilgrimage headed? And what does that give you as your pilgrim's heart? You know, many of us who are very religious sometimes don't even want God. You know, as a matter of fact, religion can be one of the best defenses against God. Do you really want him? Could you say with the psalmist, my heart and my flesh long, thirst, burn for the living God? I wonder. So very often we express in our attitudes and the way we live that we may not want him at all. We plan our own lives. We spend our money the way we want to. We develop the relationships we want. Very seldom ever ask him for his guidance. Could it be that we are on pilgrimage in a different direction than Jerusalem, that we don't really want God? I talked to a man the other day, and he said, you know, I try and be affectionate to my wife, and she resists me. I said, why don't you take a two-week experiment and just pull back? Don't say or do anything affectionate. Well, halfway through the process, she came storming into my office and said, what have you done to my husband? I said, I haven't done a thing. I just gave you what you wanted. And she says, that's not what I want. I said, why have you been holding him off? Sometimes life gives us what we want. I talked to a young man who was in real trouble because of a series of consistent choices of going against basics in life that he knew. And as a result, he was in trouble. I went to see him. And he said, how did this happen? How did God allow this? And I said, isn't that what you wanted? So very often, our lives are the result of our dominant desire being acted out in a way that God loves us enough to give us what we really want. I talked to a man who was an officer at a church in the East, and he was having an awful time with his church. He said to me, Lloyd, tell me, how do you get a dynamic, alive, and vital church? And I said, tell me about yours. He said, oh, it's dead, dead and dull. And not only that, the pastor isn't any good, and he isn't leading our church the way it ought to be, and I always vote down everything he tries to do. And I said, well, tell me, what do you really want for your church? He said, well, I don't want anything he wants. And then I said, maybe God is giving you what you want. Nothing. Interesting. If your heart's on pilgrimage, where are you headed? And do you really want God? Probably the most honest thing in this moment for many of us would be to say, up to this point, I haven't really wanted God. And then we might be able to start wanting him. If we've held him off at every turn, resisted his guidance, haven't received his gifts, said no to him, it might be just as honest to say, God, I don't want you. I want to live my own life. That may be the most honest beginning to vital, dynamic faith that any of us could know. Because out of that, God could create the desire and fill that emptiness, a longing for him. The psalmist has given us his heart's desire to be in the temple of God, to be with his Lord. And because of the dominant desire of his heart, he had the pilgrim's attitude. How wonderful. The psalmist says, blessed is the man whose strength is in you. He passes through the valley of Baca and makes it a spring. The rain also fills it with pools. Someone who really wants God has a different attitude toward the arid, drab, cragged, rocky valleys of life. Notice the progression. Because his strength comes from God, he goes through the valley of Baca, and he sees springs there, and nobody else sees the springs,
And because he dares to believe that there are springs there, he trusts God for them, and God gives him something so much better than the springs, he gives him rain. And the word in Hebrew for baka really means balsam trees, the valley of the balsam trees, where the balsam trees have their tears of sap running out of them. It also can be called the valley of the wailing, the valley of the tears. We all know them. We all go through times of problems. If God is our pilgrim's heart, we will have the pilgrim's attitude. We'll go into the problem looking for what God is trying to say to us in the midst of it and seeking to get the most out of it rather than just enduring it. We can go into the problems of life, the arid desert places that we all know all of the time, and see things other people won't see. A Christ-centered optimism isn't a belief in the goodness of people. It's a belief in the power of God and what he can do to bring springs in the desert. Have you got a desert? Some difficult problem, some person, some situation, something that needs the inflow of divine power? Do you have that? Well, that's your valley of Baca. What do you see there? We can interpret the passage in several ways. We can say that they went into the valley of Baca on their way to Jerusalem and they dug wells, perhaps. Or they found some old ones and opened them again. Or they dared to believe that God would provide exactly what they needed. And their belief that there were springs in the desert enabled God to give rains of his blessing way beyond anything that they expected. And there's the secret of cooperating with God. God gives his greatest gifts to people who dare to believe that they're possible. He only gives to the extent of our vision. If we don't see a spring in the desert, he's not going to send the rain. If we see the spring there, whether it's there or not, and with his optimism, say, why, this is not a dull, arid, dry, drab place. There are springs here. And God gives the rain. Do you need that? I think we all do. In the midst of every problem, we need the pilgrim's perspective and the attitude. Let me ask you another more personal question. Are you the kind of a person who sees springs in other people's deserts? Are you the kind of a person that others come to the minute a problem strikes and they run to you and say, hey, help me unwrap this problem and see the spring in the desert? Are you that kind of person? Or are you so negative about life and what God hasn't done and what you haven't been able to do and the way life has treated you that you're a cranky, whiny person that when others come and say, don't look for a spring in the desert, there isn't one there. Or are you a person who says, hey, wait a minute. Let me help you unwrap that problem, because inside of it, God is going to teach you something that you couldn't have found any other way. And suddenly, as you take it apart, part by part, dismantle it, take all of the tension and all the fear out of it, get rid of all of the panic, and suddenly the person says, ah, I never saw that. And the spring comes up in the desert. Oh, I long to be that kind of a person, and not a person who multiplies people's problems. And those are the people who know the pilgrim's source of strength. They go from strength to strength. That's adventuresome living, because whatever strength God gives us in one situation becomes but a prelude to the greater strength that he gives us in another situation. If we don't accept the one level of strength that he's giving us right now in the problems that we have, there's no way that he's going to give us greater strength and a greater problem in the future. We go from strength to strength by trusting him right now with today's problems, yielding them to him, envisioning the spring coming up in the desert, because we're on our way to Jerusalem. And where is our Jerusalem? Heaven. We're alive forever. And we can endure anything along the way.